10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Radiant team ban.
Hello, good evening everybody. Welcome to the Epicenter Winners Bracket CE Qualifiers between First Departure versus Mineski Esports. My name is Hades and I'll be your caster for this series, but I am not alone. Joined with me, Skens. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. And I think it would be nice to start by just talking through these lineups because I think everyone wants to know where QQ is, who's normally sort of one of the stars of Mineski, and I believe he's away on vacation. But the player who has standard next to their nickname, Ben Hur, I don't actually think he is a standard. I think he's probably in the team now. Certainly recently when I've watched them playing, Ben Hur has always been there. And for me, he's almost been the storyline of Mineski recently. I don't know if you've seen him play, but this is, for me, maybe the strongest mid laner in the whole Southeast Asia region right now. I was really impressed with the best of five that Mineski had against TNC just a few days ago, where Ben Hur was getting the better of Teehee in every single game, and Teehee's been like a really impressive mid lane himself. When it comes to First Departure, maybe this is somewhere where you'll know more. I believe Miracle's now finally back from Army forever for good. Is that true?
That I'm not too sure, but I think I'll have to clarify him. I'll ask him later on. But I know that Hana is entering the army probably in a week or two, and Kai has left the roster because he's enlisting to the army next month. So that's where we see Polisson coming in.
So my question about Singapore Dota teams, always been the same thing. Who plays support? Are they good at support? Because historically, I feel like Singapore's always produced a lot of carry players and very few support players. So, I mean, do you know who's playing supports in this version of First Departure?
Okay, let me check. Yes, okay. Miracle is playing core. Lubby and Polisson. Polisson will be the one playing the core. He's taking over Kai. So, that's definitely him in the support role. Something which he has been looking forward to, I believe. I remember speaking
already
to him a while back. Polisson, he's the one, he said that he prefers to play in the support role compared to playing the core.
But he was playing core before, right?
Oracle.
I mean, I feel like you take any professional Singapore Dota player and like at some point they were playing core and like they just kind of become supports out of necessity. Who was the last one? I think Ysera. I think Ysera's got forced to play support in the previous version of this lineup because even though he was like a mid player, just because there's an overflow of core players. So it's really promising if Polosov actually likes to play support, and that'll be good for them. But in terms of the mid lane, do you agree with me? Have you watched Ben Hur? Are you behind the Ben Hur hype?
I'm kind of behind it. I'm still giving it some time. Maybe, you know, players, teams just not really play against him just yet. Because, I mean, I agree with you. It's not often you see Teehee kind of just go falling on the back foot usually in these kind of matchups. So, I don't know. Maybe we'll see a bit more in this match. I mean, what heroes has he played so far?
I'm trying to think, actually. I think the one game he actually played mid Enchantress, which was really surprising.
Oh, wow.
It's not something we've seen in many years. Enchantress obviously banned here. It's difficult for me to not think back. I mean, I assume he plays all the standard things. I think he might have played an Invoker once. I'm not sure it's hero-based, to be honest. Like, my impression of him is that he's just like an extremely talented player. I don't know if he's like on the SEA MMR leaderboards or anything, but I didn't really know him that well until quite recently. And I've seen him play for Mineski a few times and just been thoroughly impressed every time.
Yeah, and okay, I mean, now we're really kind of pretty much into the halfway done throughout the draft. I mean, let's talk about these heroes for now. I mean, you see the Earth Spirit, OD, Drow, Batrider, Bandau. I mean, Mineski has been known to play a bit of Drow, so it's understandable. Ban, Four, and Enchantress, Chen. Is Mineski one of those teams where they really favor the jungle heroes? I don't really recall them playing those kind of heroes yet. I mean, much.
No, not particularly. The thing that confuses me at the start of this draft is that First Departure, first pick, Oracle. And to my mind, Oracle has kind of shown itself since it was released to pro Dota as a hero that's really good as a pick for particular purpose to counter something or to protect something. And as a first pick, it just seems very strange to me. It's not likely to be contested. There's nothing for it to counter yet. I mean, over here, maybe you don't want them to have Oracle against your Beastmaster because it can take off the roar. Like, is that the play? I'm not too sure. Whereas, if you compare to Mineski starting two, they had Nature's Prophet and Venge, where these are like staples. Venge is like the staple
10
support of the patch. Nature's
seconds
Prophet is maybe the most contested hero at LANs recently, at
Five
all the big
seconds
LANs. You
remaining.
see this hero banned almost every game. It's a big deal when a team lets it through.
That's
And I'm
true.
not too sure, like,
Reserve
what do you
time.
think First Departure's plan would be for the Nature's Prophet?
Okay, I'm gonna be straight out honest with you, because I mean, after speaking with Miracle a couple of times, the way he drafts, it's really very unorthodox. And I mean, even his teammates, they have mentioned to me a couple of times, like, we don't know what he's gonna draft. He just drafts, we just play. It's pretty much that. So there's no real set plan, which is why I always feel they have the surprise factor. It either really works really well, or it just crashes really bad. So I don't really think they have much of a plan besides, okay, wait, what?
Radiant team pick.
Okay, well, they have a Lone Druid, a Beastmaster, and Oracle, so they are going heavy, heavy push this game, First Departure.
But this is so greedy.
Oracle fits the push. I mean, it's, I don't know, I think it can work. I think if they hit their Necro 3
Dire team
timing,
pick.
they're gonna be very difficult to stop. Gyrocopter's alright against that. Nature's Prophet in terms of like split pushing or something, it won't come online on time. So if I look at First Departure's lineup so far, it's like very much about the Beastmaster. What kind of landing stage he gets, what timing he gets on his Necro 3. The Bounty Hunter pickup is probably designed to get underneath their skin. This is something that I like to refer to as a
10
Cloud 9
seconds
strategy, just
remaining.
because remember TI4 when people were deathballing? Nobody really knew what to
5
do, and the
seconds
response was
remaining.
always like you wait them out, you try to survive, or you try deathball back at them. And Cloud 9
6
designed this thing where they would pick the Bounty Hunter and they'd try and be
Radiant
super
team down.
aggressive before you could even start pushing. And I've seen since then many teams actually use this strategy and successfully apply it. And that's what I feel like when you see the enemy teams pushing you and you pick a Bounty Hunter, to me that suggests you want to actually disrupt them before they even get off,
Ten
before they
seconds
start pushing.
remaining.
Yeah, I mean, also, I mean, I'm just kind of curious about how you the laning
Five
phase, how
seconds
that's gonna work.
remaining.
Because I mean, your Lone Druid, is he gonna be mid? Is he gonna be in that safe lane, off lane? I mean, he's just very
Reserve
versatile
time.
here in terms of the laning phase. And I mean, seeing the Beastmaster with the Lone Druid, that's not something you usually see. But and I don't recall Wedding Crash or Miracle, being Lone Druid players. The only player I can think of who
Dire
plays this
team
hero would
ban.
be Hana. So I'm fairly confident this is going to be an offlane Lone Druid, but I'm very curious as to where this Beastmaster is going. Because if he's going to the jungle, the Bounty Hunter is going to have a ball of a time disrupting his farm. And yeah, Zeus.
10 seconds
I think this is just Zeus,
remaining.
man. I think they're just waiting on Miracle's hero last.
I see why you're saying it's greedy now, because I just assumed it's offlane
Radiant team
Beastmaster
pick.
and safe lane Lone Druid. But if you're saying that the Lone Druid's going to be in the offlane, that does make it look a lot more greedy to me too. And it gives a further explanation for the Bounty Hunter pick if they also think, hey, this is going to be a jungle Beastmaster. But I think if you're First Departure, you got to adapt and recognize that running a jungle Beastmaster against Bounty Hunter is going to be risky. And also just, it feels like there's no need. I feel like you rather
10
adjust your
seconds
players into roles
remaining.
they're not used to and run the strategy that makes sense here. It's not
5
that difficult to
seconds
play
remaining.
Beastmaster in the offlane. And it's obviously anyone who can play offlane Lone Druid could also play safe lane Lone Druid.
I mean, I could be wrong. This could
Dire
easily be a
team
Lone Druid in
pick.
the safe lane. That could be Miracle's hero, and just put the Zeus mid. That works pretty much anyways. So I still think there maybe we might see a surprise hero coming out. I mean, who synergizes well in terms of the support duo of the Oracle? I mean, you've got a fancy nuke. I think you're just missing just a bit more control. Just one more disabler. Maybe like a Lion and Earthshaker. Okay, wait, hold on. Miracle doesn't like Earthshaker. I just remembered that.
Miracle doesn't like. Do you know why he doesn't like
10
Earthshaker?
I'm not
seconds
sure
remaining.
because I. Okay, Lovie, when I spoke to him, like, I think
5 seconds
a bit before New
remaining.
Year's, he was just like, yeah, I'm not sure why he doesn't want to draft me Earthshaker. I think he has no faith in my Earthshaker, something like that.
Reserve time.
Okay. Maybe he doesn't like Lovie's Earthshaker. That's.
Maybe,
Well,
maybe. Well, Lovie has
shots
pretty good
fired
Earthshaker.
there. I mean, there was this. Miracle himself was playing support not too long ago, right? This is what I was talking about, like how the Singapore players all got a turn to play support because actually they all want to be core. And,
Indeed.
I don't know if he was playing Earthshaker himself,
Oh no, he was playing
but
Earth Spirit. That's because oh, that was purely that was
10
only
seconds
because
remaining.
I think he
Flood
wanted
will
to play
be
Earth
burned.
Spirit. So Shadow Demon, right? Oh, that's actually really, really strong. The Soul Catcher
Yeah, it's nice.
and the Oracle Nuke is very, very painful. And it's gonna be what? Okay, I'm
So
gonna
Mirko
die.
is playing support again. Is that yeah, that's what it looks like.
Is
This
it?
is I mean, you watch a team from Singapore play Dota and at the start of the game you don't know who's playing which role. That's you know, and I'm asking you and you're like friends of these guys, you're from Singapore and you don't know either. It's just
Yeah, I mean, okay, Zeus support, this is something which they have played before, but it was like many patches back. It's not out of the question as well, but seeing as that's Wedding Crashers hero, that's probably going to be a core Zeus, and yeah, it's going to be support Shadow Demon. All
Yeah,
right.
and I mean to pick Shadow Demon Oracle together is pretty cool
10
here because
seconds
as I was
remaining.
saying, the plan for Mineski is going to be to be super aggressive, and if you have these two
5
supports that
seconds
actually
remaining.
react quite well to aggression, it's almost like when people used to pick Dazzle and Tusk a lot in the West. Like, they're sure that it's a different kind of reaction, but they're both very good at punishing the enemy team for being over aggressive. So I kind of like that. Just in terms of their, you know, in terms of the cores turning around and dealing damage. I feel like Lone Druid and Beastmaster aren't really those heroes early on. It's really just the Zeus, so I'm not too sure. It is going to be Ben-Hur playing Puck, and I think that is one of the heroes I've seen him play extremely well. And I think it's a favorable matchup against the Zeus as well, so going to be an interesting test for Wedding Crash in this mid lane.
Okay, so we've spoken quite a lot about First Departure. Now back to the, I mean, Mineski. I mean, about their draft. To me, I feel it's easier to execute. So for now, I would. I mean, despite being from Singapore, I actually would favor Mineski's draft for now. I mean, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, you don't have to support the team from your
Yeah.
country. You definitely don't need to think their draft's better. I also think so. I think Mineski's draft suits Mineski very well. I think it's got really good potential for aggression in terms of dominating the lanes. And because it has heroes like Bounty Hunter, Puck, Gyro, in fact, all five of these heroes, it's almost MVP Phoenix style. Like, they can dominate their lanes, and there's a lot of potential for them to snowball out of control after dominating their lanes. It's very difficult to imagine First Departure coming back if the initial aggression succeeds for Mineski. And that's why, in some ways, I feel like the Shadow Demon pickup's nice, because they're trying to make sure they got two supports that can quell the aggression. But if the aggression goes through anyway, if the lanes work out really well for Mineski, I think they got it in the bag almost just from there.
I think Jesse Vashon is bounty hunter. He really has a lot to. He has to put a lot of weight in the, especially during the first 10 minutes of the game, if things go well. Because First Departure, like you mentioned during the drafting phase, that they have very, very strong push potential. So it feels like they're on the clock, like on who's gonna break that 15-minute mark, about who's gonna meet their optimum timings and stuff. All right, so now I'm gonna quickly introduce the teams and the players. Around the Radiant side, we have Ben-Hur playing on the Puck for Mineski, Jesse Vash on the Bounty Hunter. We're gonna see Raging Potato playing on the Nature's Prophet in the off lane. We're gonna have Jules playing on the Gyrocopter, and last but not least, we're gonna have Cast playing on the Ventral Spirit.
Yeah, and on the Dire side, for First Departure, in the off lane there's Kao playing the Lone Druid. Mid lane's going to be Wedding Crash playing Zeus. Lobby's going to be support Oracle. There's going to be a safe lane farming Poloso and what? Wait, is that right?
Yeah,
Yeah, it looks
okay.
like it. That's what they're doing.
30
And
seconds to battle.
Miracle's playing support Shadow Demon this game, and he's asking himself what's happened to QQ. All the fans want to know as well. Apparently he's on vacation, that's what we've been told. I mean, they're all joking about, oh, he's hunting girls or back to the Planet of the Apes. I saw someone in the chat earlier was asking, is Raging Potato not QQ? No, Raging Potato is actually Jay, or Bimbo. Very, very well-known player from the region. But honestly, I mean, there's so much emphasis on QQ. If you've been watching this team recently, I think the talk just has to be about Ben-Hur. And speaking of Ben-Hur, there's a little bit of action there. They're trying to kill the Spirit Bear, probably not
This is
quite
actually pretty
gonna.
huge. They can kill it. It's a lot of cash. Can they kill it? I think they can. No? Oh, deny. What?
It denies it!
Oh, what?
That's interesting. I don't think I've ever seen a Spirit Bear get denied before. I mean, normally it lives and then gets away and heals, or it dies. Interesting call from Wedding Crash. I mean, he obviously thought there would be like another projectile coming through to finish it off.
Hana's gonna have himself another bear very soon, but I'm pretty sure he's not gonna be too happy with the bear. Or did he actually? Was he actually the one to call for it, didn't I? But anyways, here we are. You can see just Nature's Prophet doing this thing, trying to disrupt the creep equilibrium a bit. I mean, this lane against Miracle and Lobby. Whoa, wait. Am I seeing this right? Are we seeing the supports actually the ones farming the lane and Polisson just farming up the jungle?
Yeah, that's what it looks like. So there's some amount of greed involved in this, especially because the enemy team is running a bounty hunter. I mean, Pelosa did start with the Iron Talon, so this is not an adjustment. This is something they decided to do in advance. They're going to run the Shadow Demon and the Oracle in a lane. The Oracle looks like he's the one that's farming. Because we're looking for a way to be like, oh, Miracle is actually carry, but it looks like it's Lovey still who's getting more value there. Maybe they'll share it. It's certainly like a... This is like, for me, I really like these strategies where you present heroes being in lanes and then actually you run one to the jungle and the lanes still go fine. But it's not obvious that the lanes will still go fine in this game. You know, like, is the Nature's Prophet not going to get a lot of value? Is the Bounty Hunter not going to get a lot of value? Isn't it a lot more difficult for them to help the Zeus if Zeus gets in trouble? If they only have the two supports laning top in the first place?
Yeah, that's true. I mean, that's one of the downsides. But, I mean, all the more to have... I think this is something they probably would have worked out in the scrims the past few days. Because I recall seeing First Departures practicing quite a bit more than they usually would. So maybe this is a strat Miracle thought up. And I mean, to see the Shadow Demon pick, I've been waiting for a while to see when he would draft this again, because this is something they used to play for quite a while. They usually keep this as a strat only for teams like against teams like Mineski. Like, they used to play this Elder Titan combo with the Shadow Demon, so I like the Soul Catcher and how that would synergize pretty well with the Oracle. So Polisson, as you can see, he's already having trouble. Jesse Vash laying down a nice sentry, and that's going to disrupt one of his camps, but still, I think he should be fine. He has plenty of camps to go to.
It's quite interesting that Jesse Vash starts with the boots, not the Orb of Venom. It's something I saw Kuroki from Liquid doing recently in a WePlay game as well. So it seems like there's something of a trend of bounty hunters sometimes preferring to get those boots. It gives you less kill potential, but it definitely makes you more mobile around the map early on. And people, I mean, it's not even that much less kill potential, because the orb would be slowing them for extra hits, and the boots sort of let you get those extra hits anyway. He's going to be harassing Pelosa a lot here.
Oh, they actually got the first blood here, because I was looking in the middle lane. It looks like Ben-Hur wanted to go and wedding Crash Ben. There we go, Oracle getting a very nice first blood. The disruption combo looks like it's paying off.
Yeah, the Oracle Shadow Demon.
Yeah, Jesse Vash is waiting for the curry, I think. He was pinging it for a while. Water Room's gonna be saved for the puck. And Ben-Hur, like you said, he's a very, very strong player. And usually, I mean, you see Wedding Crash, he's the one who is going all aggressive, and in this case, he's forced to play very, very passive, and that's not something I'm used to. Yeah, Jesse Vash just waiting.
I mean, Zeus is a hero that usually just gets farmed no matter what it's against, just by spamming Arc, but the thing is, before he has, I don't know, Puck is one of those heroes that definitely can zone the Zeus away. I mean, people often talk about how Zeus struggles to land against Queen of Pain, and Puck's almost similar to the Queen of Pain in that sense. You can get the creep to your side, stand deep, and threaten attacks, and the Zeus really can't tank that harass, so it wants to spam the Ox while staying out of range, and that's usually what results in the Puck getting extra CS.
And if you look at the map movement right now, there's just three heroes surrounding the Zeus right now, and I think they want to go in with Jesse Vash. He's going to find him. Ben-Hur falling a bit low. The tower take a lot. Tower hits the Wedding Crash. Now you see the Raging Pillar coming to the fray, and it's going to be a 1-for-1 trade. So that's still a pretty good trade-off, if you ask me.
Ben-Hur actually had Phase Shift when he died, so that was, I feel like it had just cooled down, and it was a slight misplay. And honestly, for the situation that First Departure are in, they'll be more than happy with that trade, because look at the CS, the Zeus is going to destroy. I mean, I've talked about how Pack is a favorable matchup against Zeus, but it's not meant to be that favorable. This is definitely some of Ben-Hur showing here, having 17 creeps to Wedding Crash's 7 this early in the game.
We haven't talked about this bottom lane for a while. I mean, Hana, he seems to be doing okay. I mean, he's actually top of the CS, just a bit behind Miracle, who is... Looks like it's going to be his turn to farm up this lane. It's actually going to be quite scary, because I think the economy distribution is going to be very scary. It's, I mean, about who's going to hit the timings first. I mean, it's one thing to have, you know, supports doing their job, rotations and all, but a farmed support, I think that would give you reason to worry. And here we go, top lane, Polizon, Raging Potato, tons of spells flying out, and the Oracle Nuke, he will fall. So 3-1.
Am I correct in saying, I'm pretty sure, maybe I'm confused, but Jules is normally playing support.
Hold up about that, Beast. Wait, middle lane, Wedding Crash, duking of the Dream Coil. Ben-Hur trying to find him, he has another orb. I think he's gonna go, but duked by Wedding Crash, and here comes Polizon, throwing on a ball. Can they kill who's gonna fire first? It will be Wedding Crash. And now it looks like Polizer, he's gonna be wrapped in between Raging Potato and Ben-Hur. The tree is doing quite a bit of damage, blocked by the Sprout, and one more Reckless. Ben-Hur will find himself another kill. Alright, so this global presence of the Nature's Prophet. You were saying, Scans?
I think Jules is usually playing support in this team when QQ's around. QQ plays carry, and Jules... And I see, I could be extremely confused, but I'm trying to figure out who actually is the stand-in here, because I don't think Ben-Hur is the actual stand-in. I'm pretty sure he was playing even before QQ was away on vacation.
I think you're right, Ben-Hur is the stand-in or the replacement. Speculation, we're just going to leave it a bit there. And again, the top lane, this killing of Raging Potato, this nuke proving to be very, very strong. And Miracle is actually topping the TS. He still remains ahead of the puck in terms of CS, which is quite scary if you ask me. I mean, Shadow Demon, Soul Catcher, Rift, Lubbies, Purifying Flames. And that's 198 what, nuke? Oh no, it's 180 nuke. It's really, really strong early on.
Well, the point I was trying to make is that I think Jules normally plays support when QQ's around, and QQ's the one who's playing that carry, and so it might affect the dynamic of the lane. We saw yesterday Fnatic with Ned playing carry, or there's gonna be a little bit of engagement, and Ben-Hur's gonna catch out too. He's probably gonna be able to kill Zeus, just lives himself.
Oh wait, no, Miracle still dies.
Well, Zeus manages to escape as a result of that, because Ben-Hur had to orb away, phase shift, dodge, otherwise he definitely would have gone down.
Is this... Oh wait, hold on, middle lane, they want to go in the puck again, the phase shift, one more vault, and Wedding Crash will find himself a return kill, or revenge kill if you will. I think he's not too happy of being dominated by the Zeus, I mean by the puck. I mean, usually the Zeus is the one who gets the comfortable CS pushing out the lane. And bottom lane here, Cast, taking quite a few hits on this bear, Hannah. I think he's gonna find himself a solo kill here, yes he will. And the lone druid is actually stomping this lane. I mean, I guess that's why Zeus doesn't have to worry about these rotations, because with a lone druid, you can't really leave him in a 1v1 matchup against your safe lane. Your safe lane is just gonna get destroyed.
Yeah, this is the tricky thing actually about the matchup that Mineski have, and we spoke at the start about how they want to be aggressive in the lane stage, but they actually, because they have the bounty hunter, if he doesn't want to be at the bot lane himself, the way that the Venge and the Gyro win the lane against the lone druid is by being together all the time and threatening to kill him. And as soon as one of them is not there, the lone druid crashes the lane. He can obviously kill the Venge, but even the Gyro on its own just can't handle it.
I think middle lane is gonna get a bit of a fix again. Yep, the real Dream Coil comes out, Ben-Hur ended silence as well. Jesse Bash is coming behind the tower, just gonna dive him, and Wedding Crash will fall again for the puck. Okay, he's died three times this game already, and with the Gyrocopter mint, they will just take themselves an easy T1. Fortification already been used. And this Polizon in the jungle, he's level 4, I mean, do you think it's an okay timing? I mean, we're 8 minutes in, it's a jungling Beastmaster. Oh, he gets a tower deny!
Yeah, that's pretty cool. That was with the boar, right? So, it's quite impressive. I mean, he's level 5 now, I think it's alright, especially considering he's been against the Bounty Hunter. He's still higher level than the Bounty Hunter. In the greater context of the game, I mean, what it's enabled is that Miracle's got a lot of farm and Shadow Demon.
And the Shuriken's off to cancel his TP. He's gonna try, and he's just gonna die, and their Nature's Prophet rotating in. And I think Miracle's in a bit of trouble. I think they know he's there. Yep, they do, Soul Catcher. Oh, Miracle's just gonna try and TP back. Oh!
No, there was no coils. Yeah, that's... So, I mean, the really big advantage of First Departure's laning stage this game is they've managed to get a lot of value. I mean, look at the last hits. There's a Shadow Demon right at the top there. Even the Oracle has a lot. Oracle's got 21, and if you compare the two supports on the side of Mineski, they have 4 and 3 respectively, and the two supports on the side of First Departure have 22 and 42 last hits. They're a lot more farmed. And just for me, the big question is, are they going to get value out of that? Because their cores are doing a bit worse, for sure, but their supports are doing much, much better. And I can sort of see the theory behind that, because it feels like the early game, it actually is a bit more important to prioritize your supports, because then they're the ones that are meant to control the mid game for you, to give space to the cores. But are they going to succeed in doing that? Are the Shadow Demon and the Oracle going to have a bigger impact now that they're like quite far ahead of the Bounty Hunter and the Vengeful Spirit? Because if they don't, if they just sit around and have that gold, over time it's not going to be worth it to them. The fact that their cores are less farmed than enemy cores is going to be a bigger deal.
Well, I think they should be okay. I mean, the three cores of Mineski right now, if you look at the net worth chart, they are relatively ahead by a bit. But in terms of how farmed the supports are, First Departure supports definitely have the edge. Of course, 4,000 gold ahead. Right, Sentry's gonna finally cooldown, and okay, Jesse Vash, I'm still waiting for that level 6 when the track goal comes in, and that's when you can tell Mineski they're gonna be very happy if
Oh, here comes the roar!
The lightning bolt, the ult comes out as well. Ben-Hur's gonna get away. Nope, he will not. Raging Potatoes thinking about TPing in, but no, he's just gonna die there. Jesse Vash, do they have a sentry there? Yes, the bear is chasing him down. M, oh, we get the first entangle. Root! Root, one more root. Yes, he will. Talk about RNG, and Hanam finds himself a solo kill.
That is a lucky route, if there's ever been a lucky route. It's like, just inside of the sentry's range, in time for the Beastmaster to catch up on Dust. There's no way they make the kill without that route.
Definitely, and I mean, all with Venom as well, the tiny bit of slow. And actually, I mean, Hanam, when he died at the bottom lane just now, his Hand of Miners was delayed, but thanks to the solo kill, looks like he's going to be back on track with right now. Top lane. I mean, I see a lot of heroes here. They're smoked up. Mineski thinking about going in. There's Jesse Vash at level 6. Still not yet. But I think first departure, you know, they're playing very, very passive, just retreating all the way back into the jungle. And Raging Potato is looking to the top lane. Oh, they're going for this. Miracle, do they have a sprout? Yes, and the Rocket Barrage to come on. Miracle, gonna disruption. But the cooldown comes out, and Miracle is just gonna die here, so nice pick off.
See, this is kind of what I'm talking about. Like, if you have extra value on your Shadow Demon early on, but what he's doing in the game is just dying, he's actually giving away more than a regular Shadow Demon would at this stage in the game. And he's not, you know, you're not using the advantage that he has early on to achieve that much. So while I get behind the theory of what First Departure did in the lane stage, I actually really like the idea of, you know, boosting your supports rather than your cores a bit. I do think you got to do the right things with that boost, and so far, I'm not convinced that the Shadow Demon and the Oracle are sort of like paying back what they owe the team for taking that extra space early on.
I kind of agree with you because, I mean, the Zeus, he's usually a hero who you want to be snowballing, have a huge comfortable net worth advantage, you know, finding kills around. And if your support's being unable to roam, it's really very hard for your Zeus to, you know, get any comeback farm. And he's not going to be the hero who kind of carries you past the 40 or 35 minute mark for that matter. So, I mean, I totally agree with what you're saying, and I think Hanam, oh, they're trying to go on him right here. Do they have a shuriken toss? Nope.
Yeah, Savage Roar just saving his life. How many times do we see that with Lone Druid these days? And there's no track just yet, but there's about to be... There we go, Jesse Vash level 6, and this is where Mineski's game plan really turns on.
Mm-hmm. And Miracle's gonna get tracked. It looks like they want to find Jesse Vash. Here comes Freddy Crash, and there we go. Nice double Dream Coil, but there's no follow-up. Actually, wait, the Treants are coming in. I think they want to find a Miracle here. When he crashes, he's going to find himself another kill. Will they find any more? I don't think so. Hanna's still walking back. His bear is just... I mean, you see the panda is just walking around. Maybe for a body block or two, but that's pretty much it.
The damage output of the Zeus and the Oracle and the Shadow Demon there is actually incredible. They all have such short cooldown spells. And the fact that the Gyrocopter wasn't there to right at the end, I think that's the reason Mineski can't take a fight. Like, they get the coil, but the Bounty Hunter's already dead. Nature's Prophet and Ventral Spirit are just not the heroes to, like, quickly trade blows with the burst of the Zeus and the Shadow Demon and the Oracle. So I think it's a bit on Jules. Like, if he was there, I'm not sure, like, if they plan to take that fight in advance, but if he was there, they could definitely take the fight and maybe get some track kills. Without the Gyrocopter, these small skirmishes are usually going to favor First Departure, though.
Yeah, I think that's also one of the points behind First Departure's draft. With the Soul Catcher and all this magic nuke damage, it's just about getting these kills very, very quickly before the rest of the team comes up. And I mean, also one thing to point out is that the Beastmaster has picked up his Necrobooks 1. He's almost in Necrobooks 2, and I think he's going to look to push this top tier 1 a bit.
Yeah, and remember I said in the draft, if he gets a good timing on Necro 3, they're looking extremely good. And at the moment, it looks like that might happen. Mineski gonna try and change that.
Mid lane, and looks like they're gonna find Wedding Crash. Cooldown comes down as well. Disruption, try to save Wedding Crash. He's still alive for now, but Raging Potato is TP'd in. And looks like they will find himself Hanam as well. Holosun, does he have a roar? He's gonna go on Ben-Hur. And tangled up, and Beastmaster going in. He's gonna try for cast. Miracle, he did pick up himself a kill on Jules. And the cast will fall as well. So a 3-for-1 trade, going strongly in favor of First Departure. His Miracle was falling a bit low, and they want to go in Jesse Vash as well. Do they have Dust and the nuke from Oracle? Nope, he did not have a Windwalk, so 4-for-1. Huge trade. I think they want to find one more. No, this is killing off the Treants. And this will be the T1 tower.
Yeah, so, I mean, it starts off looking okay for Mineski, but really that's just a big win for First Departure yet again. And B Beastmaster's gonna get even closer to his Necro 3. He's only about 600, 700 gold away from that now. Like, Zeus is having a hard time, but actually in this game...
Jules, you're gonna come in some Polystar! And a Rocket Barrage on the bear. Actually, Oracle Spawn is gonna finish off the Gyrocopter, so he TP's in to die!
It's not worth it at all. It's not worth it at all. And what I want to say is, there's gonna be a swap. They're gonna try and get some track gold.
Tracked up. One more right click. Actually, no, the defensive disruption is gonna save him for now. And right, he just dies. Inevitable death. And there we go.
You know, I'm thinking more and more, like, what makes sense about what First Departure are doing here is you see Mineski with the lineup that wants to fight early on with the bounty hunter, with the track, with the pack to get involved. And First Departure winning a lot of clashes, and I think it definitely does have to do with the fact that they had overleveled supports, overfarmed supports, and we said the Zeus kind of got behind as a result. Mm-hmm. But actually, in this kind of game, Zeus, Aetherlands is all he really needs. Like, he's got his Aetherlands, he's got his levels, and he can just stand back, spam his spells. And he's not really that dependent on having some other items to, like, carry the fights if his supports are doing that much extra work.
Indeed, and I mean, of course, maybe a Veil wouldn't, you know, it would help as well. The Soul Catcher and all that boosted damage output coming up from them, they're gonna just destroy these fights very, very quickly. But I mean, also, Hana, he's very close to a relic. He's 16 minutes in. This Midas is starting to pay itself off. He's 2,800 gold. He's 1,000 gold away from the relic. And actually, wait, the puck is gonna find himself the Oracle. Alright. Oh, look at that unstoppable streak going the way to Ben Hur.
Yeah, so he's definitely gonna like that. Still, I feel like the Necro 3 is coming very soon, and this is one thing that Mineski are not really ready to deal
Hana,
with.
You're going on him with the coil and the silence coming out. Jesse Bash, this is gonna be another crack kill. Hana's gonna fall. That Roy's not gonna save you from 5 heroes, and now First Departure just backing off, realizing enough they can't do anything else.
This is actually so important. It's actually so important for Mineski to keep the momentum, to keep snowballing, keep those track kills coming in, and not give First Departure an opportunity to get up that Necro 3 and assemble and just push. Like, when the enemy team is trying to assemble and push like that, it's so valuable for you to keep killing one person so that they can never beat 5, and they keep stalling and stalling and stalling, and eventually they miss their timing. I mean, there's a mech on the Shadow Demon now as well, so Mineski are doing the right thing to keep getting these kills, but actually there's gonna be a roll in the pack.
You wanna kill him off, and the nuke from the Beastmaster will kill him off, of course, some purifying flames from the Oracle, so they get themselves a kill on Ben-Hur. And I think Polisson, I think this is Necrobooks 3 on the way.
Yeah, and that's exactly not what they want to happen. I was saying it's good for them to keep getting these pick-offs, but to be picked off themselves, to shift the momentum in the opposite direction, it's gonna result in buildings being lost, almost certainly. There's gonna be a smoke from Miracle and Wedding Crash, actually, the Shadow Demon and the Zeus, heading to a different part of the map by the looks of it, even though their teammates, I think they're still gonna pressure the tier 1. Yeah, this is a wraparound.
Oh, but they're gonna find Cast. I think if you walk a bit further down, yes, Miracle, they're gonna find Cast. Disruption, nope, they're just gonna use the Soul Catcher and the Nuke Zeus. Whew, he was just defeated in a matter of seconds. And this is not looking good at all for them. Plot the Necrobooks 3 and Polisson. 40 more seconds, they could actually push at a T2 if they wanted.
Yep, and Soul Catcher with Zeus, I mean, that's another direct reason I was saying why your Zeus can be a little bit less farmed, because you've got the Shadow Demon to amp up that damage, and almost acts as if the Zeus had an extra item. And we talk about all the support items, but by the way, Hannah's got gold for a relic and then some. It's gonna be a Radiant soon on your Lone Druid, and I really think that that's like the final ingredients. We see 4 stops coming up soon for Wedding Crash and for Labby, but I think when they hit the Radiance timing plus the Necros, this is just group up and go for First Departure, and it's gonna be very, very difficult for Mineski to hold at that point.
Not to mention, I mean, even if you tried for like the Rat Dota, just a bit of split push, trying to split the heroes to First Departure, it's not gonna be easy. Oh, the courier gets sniped by Raging Potato! But thankfully, there was nothing inside. Meanwhile, First Departure, they are smoked up again. You're gonna find Jesse Bash. Here comes the Soul Catcher and the Necrobook 3. You're not running away from this. The cooldown's gonna do a bit of damage. And actually, Pulsan is very low. Miracle. The coil will cancel his TP, and Pulsan will have no choice but to stand his ground and fight. Miracle's gonna get swapped in by Kath, and Pulsan's gonna go down first. Miracle now very, very low, stuck in the tree, and stuck in the sprout, and he will die. So, alright, just a bit of gold going the way of Mineski. Gyrocopter and the puck.
Yeah, that's a. I think that's the case of First Departure getting quite substantially outplayed, to be honest. It's Like, we keep talking about how they're getting all the parts together of what they need, and they're gonna go for a death push, and it's gonna be almost impossible to stop them. But they get caught in a small skirmish, and...
Potato, TP's in, Ben-Hur, they're gonna go on Wedding Crash. Get the silence off, do they have the Orchid? Not really, and... Nope, Lubby just showing off.
Lubby can actually... I think Fortune's End on allies just takes off track, so that's pretty cool. Something that we didn't talk about before, but I think he should be able to take off track whenever he wants.
Dire's top tower is under attack. Okay, right now, Hana, he's just picked up the Radiant. This is going to be pretty huge, and he's going to start Roshan. Now you can see Wedding Crash, he's scouting for Ward. He's found it.
And you see Raging Potato, he's going for Aghanim Scepter. And that's like, for me it's very telling. Mineski, I feel like this is the kind of team that the Nature's Prophet wants to buy BKB and go fight. But I think they recognize that directly dealing with the 5-man push from First Departure, that it's not something they can do very easily just yet. And they need to set into action this kind of like Fura and Aghanim is split push the whole map and then fight. Because once you're doing that, then the enemy team's always splitting up and then you can win the skirmishes the way they've been winning them.
Now they're going for a smoke. The Lone Druid, he gets himself the Aegis, but Mineski, where will they go with this 4-man smoke? Raging Potato is going to the top lane, so... Actually, they're not that far away from each other. But they go for a wrap around. Jules is just charging to the top lane. And actually, Hana, I don't think you want to be there. Cast, the smoke is broken. Looks like they're going to go in for an engage. The magic missile is going to stun Hana and the cooldown to follow. Mineski, this is not a good position, but oh wait, Ben-Hur goes into an amazing coil and miracle and pulls on. And Dude kept himself cast. And Hana, he's going to keep on charging. He's leading the charge on Ben-Hur as the Barrier Radiance is just going to tick Ben-Hur down. And First Departure, gonna look for more blood. Jesse Vash? Nope, he's gonna win walk away, so he's fine. The puck on the other hand, TP's blinks into. Wait, he's gonna TP out? Oh, he doesn't have a TP!
He can't TP yet, but he'll be. They're not gonna find him there.
Raging Potato finds himself a T2.
Yeah, so not actually the worst situation for Mineski after end up getting the tar there. It looked like it could go much more worse. It could go much worse for them. It looked like the fight could be terrible. I think quite important that Ben-Hur went in and broke them up with his ulti, managed to get out himself and protect the retreat from his teammates.
Yep, Ben-Hur, hold on Miracle, he uses his ult on Jules. A bit more damage, not really, yep, here comes Wedding Crash, Miracle, defensive disruption, Jules is very very low, he's gonna run all the way down, trying for the TP, Hana can get a lucky route, oh actually, the Roar chases him away and Zeus is gonna find himself a very nice kill, Wedding Crash on a killing streak. And this Deuce, he's slowly yet surely climbing up the network chart.
The flavor of that's kind of funny, you know, like when Bear uses Savage Roar, it's meant to be like you're really scared, so you run home.
Middle lane, they want to go in lobby, Raging Potato, Orchid, and he just dies here. Oh, okay, so another comeback kill. And the Necro units.
You know when...
Yep, sorry.
When people run away from the Bear, sorry, this is like a silly point, but I just started it, so people run away from the Bear, it's meant to be that they're scared, and when you're TPing out, like... you're scared, you're teeping, you're going to base, and then he comes and shouts at you and you're like, apparently because you're even more scared, now you stop teeping out. it's just a bit weird. I don't know.
No, I actually haven't thought about it, but when you put it that way, it really makes sense.
Well, I mean, I think it makes sense normally. I think the way it cancels TPs, I'm trying to say, it doesn't really make that much sense. It's like, if you're already doing the best thing you can to get away, then why would getting more scared make you do something different? But that's just the flavor. The mechanics are fine. I think the spell's a bit ridiculous.
But I think it's a much-needed spell to Lone Druid before then. Otherwise, you wouldn't see any teams really picking this hero up.
Yeah, I mean, my opinion is that the meta wasn't right for the Lone Druid at that stage, and the hero might have fit into a different meta without the hero getting the new spell. But yeah, by the way, Raging Potato's gone back for the Maelstrom, so much for rushing the Ags, all the analysis I gave. It's still a split-pushing item, but it's also a fighting item, so I feel like it's maybe a compromise. It's like not the BKB, it's not the Ags, it's halfway between.
I think we want to go on Hana here at the top lane. This is probably going to be the Aegis down, the cooldown and the track, he's not running away. Meanwhile, First Departure, everyone's just, you can see Zeus, he's been four-staffing his way. They really need to save Hana right here. And he's probably not gonna use the second bear because he acknowledged that he's gonna die here. And yeah, he's caught, surrounded by five heroes and he will just die.
It's very strange to me that First Departure keep allowing themselves to get caught in these, like, split-off small skirmishes or pick-offs because their lineup and the items they have and the heroes they have is so strong if they're just five.
Okay, and actually, oh, middle lane, I think they want to go Miracle. Falling a bit low. False Promise is going to be used on him as well. Magic Missile comes out, he's just stunned. Everything coming out, and he's going to get swapped again. He's dead for sure. And the defensive disruption is going to come out. And here comes the Roar and Raging Potato, who does find himself a kill at last on Miracle. He's finally going to go down, but Beastmaster gets himself Raging Potato cast, going to go down to the Shadow Demon. And now they're going to look for a bit more blood as Mineski, they're on the run. That fight took way too long.
Yeah, and this is exactly what I was talking about. The Mineski are doing well when they isolate people, when they have a numbers advantage, and they quickly burst them down and then pull back. As soon as they allow for fights to happen where First Departure can all be involved, it's always trouble for them. And to be fair, with the Oracle and the Shadow Demon, there's a lot of delaying tactics available. You know, defensive disruption, the Oracle's False Promise, as well as even to some extent the Fate's Edict. There's a lot of tools on the side of First Departure to stall the game out, to stall the fight out, and make sure that they all get there.
Right, so now we're at 25 minutes in. This is actually quite an active game. Jesse Vash, he's just skulking around again. He finds Hannah, but I think Hannah has learned his lesson by now that he can't really stay out too far. Lubby's waiting behind him now. He's well aware of the threat of the Nature's Prophet TPing in. Alright, another TP's coming in. Jesse Vash. You can tell he really wants more blood. Even using the bolt on just to scout for him, and I think they saw him.
I think they might have got an inkling that he was there. It's really, I mean, they're still slightly split up.
Oh, they found him. I think they found him. The bolt. Oh, just off the mark. And yes, Jesse Vash will cancel his TP. They need one more bolt for the vision. Yes, they will find him. Does somebody have a gem? No.
No, they...
And middle lane. Also on getting caught on. And that's the gem.
He had a gem, yeah.
He had a gem. And Ben-Hur's going to just orb himself out. So that was a very, very significant kill and a D ward as well. So First Departure, I'm pretty sure that stalls their aggressive movement for now.
Yeah, I just don't understand. You've just killed the Bounty Hunter bot. You know that your Shadow Demon's top just farming to finish pipe. Why does the Beastmaster go mid on his own? Like, what is the thinking behind? There's so little risk to Mineski. To First Departure if they're fighting as a team.
Out. Cast is very, very low. One more right click. Actually, no, he's going to get away on 90 HP. And now First Departure, they're currently on the run. You can see the rest of Mineski just sort of trying to find someone, even coming in from the enemy jungle. And First Departure, they will retreat to the... I don't usually say this, but the safety of the enemy jungle. And they will
You know, late in the game, the jungle's kind of reversed a lot of the time. Enemy jungle's yours and your jungle's theirs. But I feel like First Departure are starting to miss their window. I honestly think they've had Necro 3 up for a really long time, and they've not really once assembled as 5 and gone for some buildings with their Necro 3. I mean, they've got like a mech, basically got a pipe, a whole lot of 4-stops, and I don't know, we're getting to a point in the game where Mineski are going to be able to force them to split up just with their split push. And I think if First Departure get forced to split up more and more and more, it's going to keep favoring Mineski.
And I think they're aware that Lubby, you know, is still in the jungle. You can see he's hiding in the trees. He has a TP out, but he's going to have to use it now. Gyrocopter? Oh no, that's not the place you want to be! They find him, and they find Ben-Hur, actually. And now, he used False Promise on himself. Lubby's going to run all the way into the trees, waiting for him to be done. Right, so he's not going to die. Yeah, they're saving the swap for him in case he TP's out. So Lubby's just going to die anyways. And actually, no, Apollo Sun's going to go straight for cast. They don't care if Lubby dies. And actually, wait, okay, yeah, he will finally fall. But, oh no, just a bit more damage. Just not there. And the courier will get knife. Now with the Zeus ult going to be used. Yeah.
You can't actually stop someone from taking the damage at the end of Oracle. See, I wonder if they know that, because I keep seeing Miracle trying to do the disruption to, like, almost like it looks like he wants to dodge the False Promise damage, but it's not actually dodgeable. It deals damage to you no matter what. Like, you'll die even if you're disrupted.
Oh, it does? Because I think I had a discussion with Ninja Boogie at Shanghai Majors. I think if you time it right, he said something like you may not die. I'm not sure if it's a bug.
I mean, there might be like one particular skill that has some interaction like that. But it's meant to be programmed in a way that there's not anything that can stop the damage from False Promise happening. That's my understanding.
Okay.
So I think it would be a bug. I think it would be a buggy interaction if you found a way to avoid the damage.
Well, you said that Mineski, you reach a stage where they can split First Departure up. I think this is that stage, this is that time. You can see the Nature's Prophet I'm pretty sure at some point he's gonna go into an eggs. Most of this Mjolnir is just for the Necro units and stuff, just for a bit of deep push. Jesse Vash is also starting to get a bit more items up. Medallion on the way. Holosun, however, I feel that besides these pickups, he hasn't really had much impact, and looks like he's gonna get caught by Raging Potato. Necro unit's gonna come out. Does he have a roar? Yes, he does, but he's not gonna turn around. Oh, he's lost a third of his HP and most of it on.
I really think it's like almost the lowest value I've ever seen a team get out of Necro 3 being rushed on Beastmaster. Like, normally you see that item come up and it's immediately, let's go for this tower, let's go for that tower. And we really just are yet to see it happen, that the team groups up and does something. And you get to a point where the Necros are not as scary, where okay, sure, you've got Guardian Greaves, you've got Pipe on your Shadow Demon. There's a lot of other items that are key for First Departure, but I do feel like the later the game goes, the more it favors Mineski in terms of changing the dynamic, because it actually usually gets more difficult to group up as 5 as the game goes later. The enemy team has more tools to split push.
Yeah, and you can tell right now the next objective is Roshan. Ben-Hur, the smoke's gonna be broken, he's waiting on that high ground. This could actually be a very, very huge dream coil, but no, Mineski looks like they will just back off. Shadow Demon Poison Ships got him out! So this is Mineski. Okay, I don't think First Departure used to smoke yet. Holosun's just waiting in the trees. He's playing around with Raging Potato. This could actually be the kill, but they have to make up their minds. The road's gonna stop Raging Potato, and I think that's the plan to kill him. Can they find one lucky entangle? One root? Root maybe? No, actually they're timing for the roar. He's gonna die anyways. So Lone Druid's gonna find himself a kill just from the Radiance burn. And Jesse Vash gonna lay out a casual track onto Lubby, who will just debuff it himself. And is this actually a lane of Rags? Are they gonna try for high ground?
Yeah, they've decided now is the time they're actually gonna push. They've got enough items in their arsenal. Beastmaster's got the Necros up here. This really should be a lane of Rags. I think it should be very, very difficult to stop them.
Okay, you're gonna ult control on Jules, you're gonna pop the BKB, the cooldown's coming out. And the Greaves, all of them are just very, very healthy, barely taking any damage from that cooldown at all, thanks to the pipe. Whole First Departure just really very tanky. Magic Missile catches onto Wedding Crash. And are they actually just gonna die? The Shadow Demon Soul Catcher destroys Kath, and there's just no buyback on the Nature's Prophet. This is one lane of Rax. And look, are they actually gonna go straight for the throne? It looks like it. Lubby.
I mean, why not? They can't be stopped.
Because Necro books do so much, and that's one T4 down. Jules using the flat cannon, trying to clear the Necro units in First Departure. They realize, alright, no, maybe we can't take the throne just yet. So they will just back out. Polisson, are they gonna cancel his TP? Yep. TP's gonna get cancelled, and First Departure will re-engage. Polisson track and homing missiles coming in. Oh, Raging Potato's gonna TP right in the middle. Three heroes, not gonna cancel right there. The Lone Druid killing off the puck. Cooldown coming out, only landing on the Miracle with the first missile. Laying out more poison, and Jesse Vash falling very, very low. But no, look, okay, wait, the buyback's been forced out. Here comes the TP. Raging Potato behind enemy lines and will just die, not getting anything out of that with no buyback. So the missile's gonna land on Wedding Crash again, and Mineski really looked very lost and very conflicted in what to do.
Yeah, I mean, I think they became a bit complacent because First Departure, which confused me, took so long to go for this group up and push. Mineski, when it finally came, they just weren't ready at all.
Very slow. Jules forced to pop his BKB and the Glimmer Keep to follow. Nice foil landing on the bear. So is that 5 or 4? 4.5 maybe, but Polisson popping the pipe. Necro units up in a bit, in 10 seconds they're gonna go straight for the throne as they realize Mineski can't really do anything about this. Cooldown's gonna come on again, but Pipe, most of the damage is gonna be very heavily negated right now. So First Departure, this is the GG push, and Jules will call it. So game 1 going the way of First Departure.
Yeah, by the time they actually do it, I don't know if this proves my point or if I was just wrong, but I feel like this is something they could have done a long time ago, grouped up as 5 and be unstoppable. But maybe they felt like having the pipe and the Greaves complete were sort of the key to absolutely now guaranteed they can't stop us. And if that's the case, then fair enough. And I think good thinking from First Departure. It's actually, it turns out to be very impressive. I said that the talking point for the game early on would be, how did the Shadow Demon and the Oracle do? Because they played them, First Departure played with 5 cores this game, really. They played with 5 cores. And they made it work, I think. I think the Shadow Demon and the Oracle are probably the MVPs, and this is a clever draft, and you got to feel a bit for Raging Potato, because to be outdrafted, you were saying it yourself in the draft, to be outdrafted by Miracle, and he seems to just kind of YOLO bits in the draft and do what he feels, you know, this seems like a cool thing to do. It's difficult to understand. I don't know if they could have anticipated this.
Yeah, I agree. Alright, so for now, we're going to take a quick break. This is the end of game one. We'll be back for game two shortly. My name is Hades. You can find me at Hades.tv on Twitter and Facebook and at Scancer as well on the social media. So we'll be back shortly. See you guys soon.